Yes, yeah. Yes, yeah. Yes, yeah. Yes, yeah. Yes, yeah. The governments of people have something in common. Yes, yeah. If we're honest. But it's clear that the change in society happened despite, not because of, the media. And the change in society forced change, however grudgingly, however limited, upon the media. Right, so that's clearly the way that Arrow tends to point. So the media isn't the driving force for change in society. But I suppose the question is, to what extent can it hold back change? To what extent can it prevent struggles? Now, if the media were all powerful, there'd have been very few struggles in the past century. It does sometimes reflect divisions in society. Those divisions can sometimes give rise to struggle. It does sometimes fuel anger, but it very rarely encourages protest. But on countless occasions in the past century, people have been forced to take part in protest, despite the media's opposition. Now, the degree to which the media can convince you a struggle is wrong is often determined by your closeness to the events. Again, personal experience is crucial. So during the miners' strike, surveys found that if you lived in Yorkshire, you're much less likely to believe the media's lies than people living in the home counties where there weren't mines. Of course you were, because you had experience, direct experience of this. You knew it was lies. But they also found, the surveys, that being linked into networks that challenged the ideas in the media made a difference. So members of trade unions were much less likely to believe the lies about the miners' strike. So if we want to counter the ideas in the media, the existence of networks that can transmit alternative ideas is crucial. And that's an important point, because when Tony Blair pulled New Labour to the right, supposedly to satisfy the demands of the media, supposedly to make New Labour electable, what he was actually doing was sawing off the branch that he was sitting on. Right? So by attacking the left in the Labour Party, by attacking the unions, by attacking the idea that the Labour Party could fight for social change, what he actually did was actively try to destroy the very networks that were capable of challenging the media's influence. And so when Murdoch switches back to the Tories, you've got a demoralised, more dejected Labour Party, less capable of taking up the fight than when Tony Blair came to the helm in 1994. Now, of course, when the level of class struggle is high, the strength of these networks that can challenge the media is greater. The feeling that the bosses know nothing, that we could run things better, is stronger. The higher the level of class struggle, the more immunised people are to the reactionary ideas in the media. So resistance certainly can take place in spite of the media. But the media and people's memories of it don't just stop existing in a period of high struggle. And I want to talk about two things, really, which is how the media can sometimes become the target of resistance, both inside and outside the media, and also how the accumulated effect of the media over the years can still hold back struggles. So, on the recent march against the Israeli storming of the flotilla, lots of the speeches were directed at the BBC. Right? So people actually start to challenge the media in a time of struggle. If you want to take it up a level, in Greece, striking teachers stormed the television station and broadcast their point about pension reform on national television. They wouldn't leave the television station until they were allowed to make the broadcast. Inside the media too, a confident workforce can struggle with management over the content they put out. So the media's power is constrained by the level of class struggle in society. Both outside the media and within the media, what the owners and editors can do is constrained by the level of class struggle. Just to finish, I think by understanding how the media works, by locating the media within a Marxist understanding of the system as a whole, we can see how its role in promoting the ruling ideas in society can be overcome. So we can see that it isn't just this evil conspiracy to promote the actionary ideas that can't be defeated, and that the road to challenging it doesn't just lie at the level of countering the ideas, but is a part of the struggle against the system as a whole, against the system that the media tries to uphold. So we can understand that the bias of the media is a consequence of the class nature of capitalism, of the concentration of ownership, of the cost-cutting in search of higher profits, and that effectiveness of the media is constrained by the class contradictions of capitalist society, by the need to sell to working class people, the need to convince working class people, the difficulty of overcoming ideas that clash with experience, the fact that capitalism sometimes forces people to fight back and gives them an experience of that as well. But the media, and our upbringing in general, can create an ideological framework within which people interpret events. It can help to shape the debate, and that means that often, even at the height of struggles,
even when people have the confidence to reject the lies in the media, to challenge the media, to storm television stations, and so on. There's still the cumulative effect of decades of life under capitalism on people. So what you get is you get a clash between the revolutionary logic of their activity, the proof that actually they are capable of transforming society and running it for themselves, and the old ideas that they still hold after years of living under capitalism. So at the height of struggles, you get this question, do we escalate the strike or do we call it off? In Bolivia, when they take over the capital city, it's controlled by elected people's councils, the president's forced to flee. Then comes the question, there's going to be an election in 3 months, so shall we go home and wait for it or not? And you get a clash between the logic of their struggles, so there's no need to go home and wait, and the ideas they still hold that actually you can't stay out there, you have to go back at some point, you have to wait for the elections, you have to let someone else run society. And that clash, what determines who wins that clash, is not so much the immediate ideas in the media, although the accumulated effect of the media does actually, is what breeds those old ideas. But what determines at that key, crucial moment in struggle, whether you win that battle for ideas or not, is whether there's an organisation capable of promoting a way forwards for the struggles and articulating a vision of a better world. Whether there's a revolutionary paper, for example, that can counter the lies in the media, that can learn from what the media does, actually engage with people's experience, have ideological, socialist ideological rather than bourgeois ideological content of its own, and rather than say there's nothing you can do about society, point the way forwards for activists and show what you can do about society. So the media is a tool for promoting the ruling ideas in society, but it's not all-powerful, and in the final analysis, at the crucial turning point of history, what will determine whether those ruling ideas win out, or whether a mass movement can go forward and transform society, is not the media, but the strength of revolutionary organisations rooted in struggles and challenging the ideas of the ruling class.
I think that it's important that we look at what's actually happening on our televisions as well. When our son was 5, every day he asked me if he could change his name. My son's got a West African name, it's Kamara. And he wanted to change his name to Michael or Jack or John or something. And I asked him, well, why do you want to change your name? He said, because every time I see a black man on the television, he's either a gangster or he's a drug dealer or he's in problem. And when we look at, when we see stories on Africa, they're always starving children, they're walking barefoot, they're always hungry. And this is coming from a child that has this perception that's coming from the television, from the media. And it's okay to say that I believe what you were saying before, that the media can't influence. But I think that's okay if you have the ability and the capacity to deconstruct it and critique it. But if you're a young child and you keep on seeing images of black men or black women, in a derogative manner, then you know that's the perception that you're going to have of yourself and others as well. Thank you.
And then another one comes along, which is another sort of liberal theory. This again is a sort of carte blanche for the media to do what they like. You know, an endless overdose of sports, of celebrity, and underrating the cognitive potential of the audience, and just infantilizing us. So number two is an infantilizing model. But there's also another one, which I call the Melvin Bragg view of the media. The liberal one, this is the epiphenomenon model. You could say the media there, they reflect the world, but they don't impact on the on our lives. This is, it acts like a closed circle. We're always like Narcissus, admiring our own reflection. So how do we break this closed circle of identity thinking? Well, we need Marxist Hegelian dialectic. We need a triad. We need non-identity thinking to get out of this circle. For instance, just very quickly, great art didn't civilize the Nazis. Show the Nazis an anti-racist film or fascist film, and they'll just interpret it to reaffirm their views.